My name is Jim Courtney. I'm a graduate of 66 Engineering Science. And in fact, interestingly enough, today our speaker is one of my classmates from that year. And I'll be chairing the session today. We'll start off by having lunch. Around 1:20, we'll call for a bio break. We spent our first year in class together in engineering science, and engineering science had a reputation for about 50% of the class moving on somewhere else in second year, and Levy moved on to chem engineering. And I think it was that physics problem that Don Ivey gave us, show that if you carry a trunk up three flights of stairs and take that back downstairs, you've done no work. There we are. So, Levy went on. Levy went on to get a MS. Sorry, it was an MEng, an MSc. M what?
MASc.
MASc. Sorry, an MASc in chemical engineering and his PhD. And he went out and worked for a while, and he may tell a little bit about that. And then he joined the chemical engineering department in 1979. And he said he almost accidentally fell into this food engineering activity. And you can see there a list of the different types of food processes he got involved in. Significant publisher of publications and holder of patents, and has had several recognitions, including the Queen's Diamond Jubilee Medal and the Professional Engineers Ontario Engineering Medal. Is that the same one that the Dean just recently got? The Professional Engineering Medal?
Yeah,
that's the Dean of, sorry, what's her name?
Dean Christina Mann.
Christina Mann. She just got awarded that medal. Those of you who read my last email, I put a link to that page. So he's going to talk today about the role of food engineering in international development. I'm not going to steal his thunder. You can read a bit there. But we need a moment to switch devices, and Levy will start his talk.
My name is Levente Diosady. I'm a professor of food engineering in the Department of Chemical Engineering.
The faculty, I think, needs somebody to replace me, so you should be aware of the need. Anyway, the title today is The Role of Food Engineering in International Development. To start off with, well, many of you don't know what food engineering is. We have different ideas, but basically food engineering deals with the application of chemical engineering principles to food processing on a large scale. I don't even know where the kitchen is in the house, but if somebody wants something for 20 tons, then we can handle that. Is this okay, or? How did I turn up the volume?
Maybe if you can pull it up.
Okay, I can do that, but the problem is I'm probably going to wave it around, so it's going to make it worse. Anyway, looking at it sort of graphically, we are sort of at the intersection of biochemistry, food science, and chemical engineering. The goals of food engineering are to provide food that is safe, nutritious, and attractive, and at a cost-effective manner. As Bill Gray taught us, an engineer is somebody who can do for $1 what everybody else can do for $2. So we're supposed to do the same thing. By the way, the food industry is primarily concerned with safety. It's not altruistic. If they didn't, they'd be out of business very quickly if you started killing off your clientele. So food safety is always the top thing for every food person, food scientist, food engineer. The food industry is the biggest industry in the world. It's also the biggest industry in Canada. And most people take this for granted and don't really realize it. Even the meat industry is the fifth largest industry in Canada. So food engineering uses many of the same unit operations as chemical engineering, and I won't go into that. The chemical engineers know, and the rest of you don't care. But the difference is that we do worry about microbiological safety, and we also need to worry about toxicity of the things that we make and how we make them. And most foods are, of course, a lot more sensitive to temperature, and we need to worry about what this stuff tastes, looks, and feels like. Now, the adequate supply of safe, nutritious food, and I shouldn't be reading the slides, but this is critical. It is the critical foundation of both individual and national development. If you don't have a safe, sound supply of food, you can't expect your population to operate and to grow and to be healthy. So the world is not short of food, and chemical engineers have a lot to do with that. But they look at the development of the Haber process, which is for fixing nitrogen, or pesticides and other chemical interventions in the food supply. The food supply has increased by fivefold since 1900, and it will need to increase by another fivefold in the next 50 years. Famine at this point is strictly the result of distribution and post-harvest losses. We lose about 40% of what we grow. Now, my own current research interest is looking at improving the food supply, not quantitatively, but qualitatively, primarily through micronutrient fortification, which I'm going to talk about, but also looking to protein processing, which is supplying nutritious food in another way, and also edible oil processing. Now, micronutrients are key chemicals that the body needs to operate. They are required in small quantities, that's why they're micronutrients. I guess the biggest one would be calcium and iron, which we need almost a tenth of a gram per day, down to vitamin B3, where we only need about 2 or 3 micrograms per day. Think that will help? I can try. You let me know. I'm fine with it, either way. Yeah, it sort of wanders around, actually. I try to put it in. Thanks very much, Peter.
Thank you.
Anyway, the lack of three key micronutrients, iodine, iron, and vitamin A, are responsible for some sort of disease in one person in three in the world. The numbers are humongous, and you can see much of that is concentrated in the southern hemisphere. So multiple micronutrient shortages are present in a great number of countries, but iodine, iron, and vitamin A are short. What are the results? Well, lack of iodine essentially results in poor nervous development. And this is a picture from Nepal. These are both the same age people. The person on the right has been stunted in development due to lack of iodine in the diet when it was growing up. The lack of iron results in anemia, which is a loss of energy primarily, but it also results in increased maternal mortality in a big way and impaired development. And some 600,000 women a year die during childbirth from complications due to poor nutrition. And again, this is pretty widely distributed. It's interesting to note that Canada is not off this map either. We do have people that have poor iron nutrition. In the south, primarily due to the fact that women go into stupid diets, but in the north, it's due to essentially poor diet. The best way to get around this is to improve the diet, but that requires a lot of changes. So we know from Canada that we've been preaching for 60, 70 years on how to improve your diet so you'd be healthy, and we're still nowhere near having a really properly healthy diet. We still have way too many calories, way too much fat, way too many other things that we put into the diet which are not necessary. So the change is very slow. It's going to take 100 years or more before the world is going to be essentially on a proper diet. However, fortification of food is immediate. You can boost up a micronutrient immediately. And the nice thing is that it is transparent to the consumer. We don't even think about the fact that we iodize salt. We put B vitamins into flour. We do vitamin D in milk. And this has to be expanded to the rest of the world. The problem with fortification is dosing. You have to make sure that you reach everybody that needs it, and you reach it at a level which is neither too high nor too low. So you have to get some kind of a staple that is uniformly eaten by everybody. And so the list is fairly short. There's salt, rice in Asia and many other parts of the world, tea in Asia, and cooking oil in, again, much of the developing world. The ideal carrier is salt. Nobody makes their own salt. You really have to buy it from a central source, so it's a place where you can have an intervention relatively easily. The interesting thing is that the intake of salt is very similar within a society. It is dosed more closely than most drugs. Okay, so even in our society, the most person who is really a high salter against somebody who's a low salter is in the order of 20% only. So again, you could have a most therapeutic drugs within that sort of an area and range. So salt is an ideal carrier. The problem, and I won't have too many chemical equations, but I'll have a couple anyway. The problem is iodine is unstable in its elemental form. It evaporates, it sublimes. It's one of the classical demonstrations of this particular phase change. And if you add sodium potassium iodide, which is what we do in Canada, it will oxidize and evaporate over time, so we have to put in some sort of stabilizing agent, which is sugar in your salt. Or if you're in the tropical countries, we can provide it as potassium iodate, which is already oxidized, but it can be reduced by impurities and other substances in the food. And in this case, the iodine sublimes and is lost. And the loss of iodine is accelerated by iron, and the chemistry is fairly clear. And the problem is not only that you lose the iodine and it's brought positive effects, but you also reduce the bioavailability of iron, so you reduce its effect as well. So almost 20 years ago now, we initiated a program to develop salt, double fortified with iodine and iron. And we decided to base this on microencapsulation, where we provide a physical barrier between the two different components so they don't have a chance to interact. And the long-term vision for salt double fortification is that it will be a key item in providing sufficient amount of both iron and iodine to reduce anemia and improve nervous development in children. So we set out a system that would essentially would get into salt and essentially survive under the conditions of the third world and would have no effect on the taste or appearance of the salt, because of course you eat food for its taste and appearance. The process is fairly complicated, and this is definitely a slide you're not supposed to show because it has too many different boxes in it. But it sort of gives you an idea of the steps that you have to go through. You have to understand the chemistry. You have to then define what are the specific needs of the consumer in terms of not only the chemistry, but also in terms of appearance, in terms of taste, in terms of color. And then come around and match all of these things so that you can match the salt that is present in a certain market, piloted in a larger scale, put to a production test, and then find out if it works. And so then you do field trials and talk to people and find out whether it's acceptable or not. It wasn't a trivial problem. Different iron sources and different conditions gave you a rainbow of different colored salts. I still have lots of these samples, and they go on my driveway. They're not really used for anything else at this point. And we ended up with a solution where we make a little particle. This is the size of a grain of salt, okay? So a third of a millimeter from here to there. There's a central core of ferrous fumarate. Ferrous fumarate is an iron source that is tasteless. Most iron sources taste awful, like rusty pipes. And so this is the problem with it. It's dark red in color. So you put it into salt, it looks like mouse droppings. So people wouldn't eat it. So you need to somehow change the color. So we put a layer of white titanium dioxide around it, and then we coat it with a vegetable oil or soy stearine, which prevents then the interaction with any moisture in the system. So you protect the system, the iron, from reacting from anything. In the lab, it's reasonably easy to do. On a larger scale, we use a fluidized bed agglomerator. And what happens here is that as air blows up, the particles are lifted and they behave like a fluid. And then you can spray in a glue to agglomerate it to the size you want. And then you turn it around and you spray down and you coat it with the stearine to make sure that it is actually properly protected. Once you've got this, you have to do a whole bunch of other things to make sure that the system actually works and can be put into place. So we develop field tests, for example. We need to be able to do quality control on this in an environment where the plant operator may have grade 8 education. If that, there is no real lab. You're living in an area where there's a lot of dishonesty in the system, so people might try to save either the work to put the material in or the actual cost of the material to put in. So we have to develop some in-field technology that somebody can do readily, and I'll show you in a minute something that can do that. We tested the stability in the lab, we tested it in the field, and we also tested the acceptability of local foods prepared by double fortified salt in 15 countries. The one which is really neat in the end is that we field tested this with 5,000 people in Ghana first, and then with 3.5 million children in India later, quite effectively, and I will show you that in a minute. First of all, talking about the field test, kit, essentially, this are the instructions that come on the sheet, and the kit includes two different chemicals that you put in, and it shows here that you shake it around, and then you develop a color, and then you match it against the included, the included card chart. So if it's light, then you look at it from above because it gives you a darker color. Otherwise, you look and you can read off the approximate composition of iodine in the system. For the field test to see if the thing is going to actually survive, we went in and obtained the same types of packages that they sell the salt in Kenya and Nigeria. They sell the salt in 200 gram sachets, which are people really don't have the money to buy 2 pounds, 2 kilograms at a time. And these sachets are packaged in groups in bales of 30, and these are then sent to the stores. And what we've done is we made up a bunch of these 30 packs, out of which 29 were different test samples for us, and one of them was an instrument that measured humidity and temperature and also shock. And we put it out in study locations in both the lowlands and the highlands of Kenya, and both the lowlands and the dry area of Nigeria. So essentially at four different climatic areas. And we could see that the temperature varied all over the map. By the way, the low temperature is the airplane, both here and there. And you saw that the humidity was slowly rising up. So the packaging was very important. It kept the thing from getting wet and from reacting. We went to a number of different places to find out where we could have the local study. This was a planning meeting outside Dhaka in Bangladesh, which was an eye-opener for me. And this is a compound for an extended family of about 40. They do their cooking on the local thing. This oven, essentially, these two holes is where the woman stuffs in straw and fires underneath, and under the third hole, over the third hole, is your pot where the food is actually being cooked. We went to see how it's bought and sold in the market. Kind of interesting to know that there were 15 people in this thing, which is rather tight. Anyway, in the Nigerian tests were very good. After 8 months, you can see that the number of anemic children after 8 months compared to the green ones are the ones that didn't receive the double fortified salt. The ones that received double fortified salt had 25% less anemia after 8 months. So this was encouraging, and so we went and started into trying to scale up our process to an industrial scale. We did most of this in New Jersey, and we went up. As a good chemical engineer, you have to sort of go in steps in scaling up because things don't really scale as you expect. And so we started from 6.5 kilo lots and ended up with 600 kilogram lots, which is approximately 1 million one-day dose of double fortified salt. And we transferred the technology to a company in India, and right now 5.5 million children received this double fortified salt. After 8 months, 1 million children were cured of anemia just by simply changing their daily school lunch from what they had before to having one prepared with double fortified salt. Proof positive, I was there. This is sort of a small intermediate size equipment. We took the technology to two different companies, both of them pharmaceutical companies outside Mumbai. This was a slightly bigger one, and this is the one that's been used. This particular fluidized bed machine is the one that's been used for most of the iron premix production that's going on right now. And commercial production pilot has been started, and this is done somewhere in Tamil Nadu in the southern end of India. All of this has been supported by the micronutrient initiative, which is a NGO supported by the Canadian government. And they actually put in large-scale equipment for mixing DFS into place in Africa, Mombasa, in this particular case. It's a sort of an inline mixing that allows you to put the iron premix that we prepare into the salt itself, roughly 1 to 200. The interesting sideline, the American universities have did a study on tea pickers in northern India, and the results were interesting for two reasons. One of them is we expected that it will improve iron status, so that's expected. But we didn't expect that it also improved cognitive scores for these women. So even though people think that you can't make people smarter once they're older, you know, if you're really stressed, then you're not as smart as you should be. And so we even ended up with essentially raising the IQ of these tea pickers by accident. So this thing is in place. We are feeding 5.5 million kids every day. The Canadian government pays for the iron premix, and it is strictly in the school program, and the result has been that the Indian government now has mandated that all school programs will have to, in due course, go over to DFS double fortified salt. We had problems remaining with this initial approach. If you look at the micrograph, you see that the surface of the particle, because it's been put together by combining fine particles of ferrous fumarate and gluing it together, has an uneven shape. And as a result of the uneven shape, it needs a lot of coating material to coat it properly. And even this way, there are holes in them. You know, so the coverage is not perfect. So one of my ex-students came up with the idea of why don't we, rather than make the particles this size through agglomeration, through the fruit-based material, why don't we try to extrude it? And so we actually already had a very nice little extruder, which we use for our rice, which I'll mention later. And what we do now is essentially make angel hair pasta. Okay, we make ferrous fumarate into a very thin strand, which is about 300 to 400 microns in diameter. And this is not color because it's scanning electron micrograms, but you can see that we end up making little cylinders, which we cut into essentially square pieces, which have a very smooth surface and it's quite compact. So it requires a lot less surface coating because it's uneven. Requires less material to color mask it, and ended up with very nice white colored particles. And it shows what happens. The ferrous fumarate powder is red when we make little cylindrical bits out of it. And again, this is the size of a grain of salt. Okay, so they're very small. They are quite compact. We tumble them in TiO2, which makes them white, and then we coat them with fat. And when you put them into salt, you can see these are the salt crystals. They're about more or less the same size. And they won't ever be identical because salt is translucent. So it's a nice crystalline material. But this is also white, so it's very difficult to see in thinking. So we changed from this popcorn shaped things into these well-defined cylindrical things. We piloted this in Jaipur. At the end of it, we found that there is some refinement to be made, which is being done in a big project that's starting now. But anyway, we managed to get the iron in there, and we managed to make the appearance to be quite good. And we are well along to doing a much less expensive, less sophisticated way, using locally made equipment to provide the iron premix for this. It actually uses a simple candy coater for putting the last two layers on. So that is sort of the summary of where we are with the salt project at this point. I also mentioned there are other desirable carriers. There is rice. We worked on rice with the outfit called PATH, Program for Appropriate Technology for Health. PATH has inherited. They're primarily into things like vaccines and medical devices and tests that you can do without hospitals, without refrigeration, so appropriate technology for the third world. And they were donated an idea of what they called ultra rice. And the thing with ultra rice is essentially when you take rice flour, which is made from broken rice grains essentially into a flour, you can fortify it, add to it any kind of fortificant you want, and then you can stick it back together and extrude it to look like rice grains. And so ultra rice was obtained by PATH, which had an office both in Canada and down in Seattle. And they came to us, me particularly, to see if we can make ultra rice, which contains vitamins B and iron, and which also are stable and look reasonable. Problem with iron always is nothing looks reasonable and nothing tastes good. So it's a very clever technology, because what you do is you take ordinary rice flour, you add your micronutrients, in this case, and then you add sodium alginate. Sodium alginate is easily dissolved, it's dispersed very well. And then after you extrude the grains, you spray them with calcium sulfate, and the sodium alginate cross-links and forms a network around the grain and sort of holds it together. And problem with it's pretty good, okay, because you still have raw rice, you didn't cook it. So it will behave once you cook it exactly the same as if you had real rice grains. And you can really load this with a lot of micronutrients, and then you take this and mix it into market rice 1 to 200. So you don't have to share a huge amount of it, and so it is a very elegant approach. Well, we worked on, completely reworked their chemistry, their antioxidant systems, so that the different items that we added didn't interact, that they stayed stable, and they could stay stable in the ultra rice for essentially, the goal was 9 months, because by that time it turns over. And actually one of my students, who is now a professor at Pomona at the University of California, Cal Polytech, went down and introduced this in both Brazil and Colombia, and it was actually commercialized there. Then they're working on putting this into India. It's got a long way to go. But anyway, we have developed a formula that worked. We showed it. We actually made stuff that looked really, really quite decent. And we also came up with a better way of sticking it together. Rather than spraying the material at the end and sort of forming an outside net that holds everything together, we set it up so that we would have a diffusing reagent that would set up this as a network, as a complete cage, from the inside out rather than from the outside in, which resulted in rice grains that, I'm not sure how well, yeah, it doesn't look too bad. Essentially, it looks very much like actual rice when it's cooked. So we're quite pleased with the result, and hopefully that it will be a little bit more widespread. Thing with rice is, of course, if you fortify rice, you can't reach the people that are out in the country. They grow their own, so they, you know, they don't care. They won't buy the ultra, they won't buy the extra, and they won't mix it. So this is not a way to reach people who are in the poor part of the world, in the rural areas. However, it is very good for the large crowded cities where everybody has to buy or barter for their rice. So then we come to the third of these desirable carriers, and that is tea. We have been very fortunate in getting a grant from the Grand Challenges Canada to a program called SLAPS, Saving Lives at Birth. There is Saving Lives at Birth is a grouping of donors that includes the Grand Challenges Canada, USAID, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the English English Grand Challenges UK, and the Norwegian Royal Family. Okay, so these five groups put up a fair bit of money for projects for preventing maternal and infant death at birth. We were the only group there that dealt with prevention. All the other groups were dealing with medicines and devices. So, you know, what you do in the case of a low setting, how do you prevent a woman who goes into a problem during labor, how do you stop hemorrhage and all that kind of stuff. And quite often what happens, of course, is the women die of hemorrhage because they don't have enough blood, they don't have enough iron. So if you can bring up their iron status, their chance of surviving is improved significantly. So we sold this story and it was believed. And so we had a preliminary 2-year grant, which expires in 7 days. And to show that we could actually iron fortify tea. Now, the reason for this is that in iron deficiency is very high in South Asia. It's 40% in the developing world in general. It's over 50% in women in India. And it's almost universally consumed, and it's also consumed relatively at the same level, again, which meets our parameters for fortification. An average Indian, doesn't matter what their social status is, will drink 2 to 8 ounce cups of tea a day, give or take, okay? And the difference is if you're a very rich person, you drink it out of silver and you get a better quality tea, but essentially it's the same thing. So the daily consumption contains about 5 grams of tea leaves. And if you can put 2.5 milligrams of iron on it, you can provide 30% of the daily requirement. You don't want to provide all of it because the food already provides something. The persons are, even though they're anemic and they're low in iron, they're not totally devoid of iron, so you don't want to shock their system by providing way too much. This gives you an idea of the distribution of tea drinking. All this is South Asia, from here to there, and the rest of it is the rest of the world. So if you can hit in here, especially if you can get into India, you can hit a very large population in the order of 1 billion people who are tea drinkers. Now the challenge tea is totally different from the challenge of iodized salt. If I'm not sure how much you would be exposed to this in practice, but tea, of course, contains a number of polyphenols, which is their active ingredient, which is also a positive. These polyphenols will react iron to form dark complexes. And these complexes, you can see, if you have tea, which is regular, and you fortify it with iron, it becomes almost black. And, of course, this is not only black and unpleasant to look at, it also has the typical iron taste, so it would be totally unacceptable. On top of that, the iron that's there is not bioavailable. So even though you can add any amount of iron you like, the person drinking the tea doesn't really get any of it. This is also a bit of a problem in a sense that the people don't really get enough iron because they don't eat any meat. They're primarily vegetarian or they eat very little meat. And so their iron intake in a form which is readily absorbed is relatively low. And so if you take your iron from vegetable sources, much of it is bound up and it's not really absorbed. So don't believe Popeye, it doesn't work. You get practically no iron from spinach at all, because even though there's lots of iron in there, it's tied up as an oxalate and it's not really absorbed by the body. Now if you drink tea at the same time, then you get nothing. So there is a bit of a worry about these people drinking tea and also not getting less iron as a result. So being able to provide the iron to tea would be a pretty good coup. And so so this is sort of the basic process of making tea as it stands. You pick the leaves and you allow them to dry, you crush them to small particles, and then you do fermentation, which is called fermentation but isn't. It really is an oxidation, as I can do with microbes. And then afterwards you dry it out and you put it out. So what we want to do is we want to be able to get in here somewhere. Somewhere in here. And provide iron. So the technical challenge is that you've got to provide the iron in a bioavailable form in a way that doesn't interfere with either the taste, texture, color, or anything of tea. And not only that, it has to get from the leaves back into the water so you can actually digest it. So our approach is to adhere the iron to the tea leaves themselves. And then when you brew the tea, then this would detach, and then you would drink it in a form that hopefully is bioavailable. We looked at three different approaches. The most complicated one would be to microencapsulate whatever works and have that essentially sitting on the tea leaves and be ingested. And the particles would have to be so small that your tongue doesn't really feel it, so it has to be in the order of 10 microns or less. So that's one potential approach. But even then you have the problem of how do you make the iron bioavailable in the presence of tea, which would tend to complex it. And the complex formation happens fairly quickly, and it will actually happen in the digestive tract itself. So our approach and our invention or idea is that if we can have another agent which can complexes the iron, but which is bioavailable, then we would have a strategy where you'd have competition between the T polyphenols and the other conjugate that we add. And so that's the approach we have followed, and it's been quite successful. This is the way tea normally looks. Raise my arrow. Okay, this tea really looks. If you don't do anything except add iron, then you get this really dark, black, miserable thing. And if you add a bit of another chelating agent, then we can lighten the color and come back to the same place. We have also done that and found out that we can check and the bioavailability is indeed there in this particular form of the tea. On Friday morning, I'm talking to Tata in India, which is the largest manufacturer of tea, together with another Canadian company that wants to sort of promote this and get it out through them. The deal with the grand challenges is that we make it available, not free, but essentially at with minimal or very low profit to the people that are poor, and then we're free to market in any way we want to. So I have acquired a Canadian company that is a beverage formulator, and they think they can make tons of money out of this, and I will look for it. My main interest is to make sure, to make sure that the poor people will actually get it in the end. My operation in this field is entirely, senior moment, anyway, we give it away for free. Okay, so what's happening now? We have the extrusion-based DFS process. It's been piloted. It's being piloted again next month, But we received a grant from IDRC to make this commercial in the next 2 years. A consortium has been put together where it's described better here. Our job at Toronto, one thing what we get funded on is to transfer technology to an Indian manufacturer. The manufacturer has been identified in Jaipur. We worked with them before. They're a really good company, and they know how to do stuff for cheap. And they are also in the business of producing complementary foods for the Indian government, so they are aware of the distribution system as well. The Uttar Pradesh government will provide double fortified salt for 20 million people for 2 years. So their commitment is in the order of $40 million to do this. You need 3 kilograms of salt per person per year. And so for 20 million, that's a big pile of salt that has to be done. And it's a very big pile of premix that somehow we're going to have to put out in the next 2 years. Now, the gain is the Global Alliance of Infant Nutrition. They're based in Switzerland. They got together with the Gates Foundation and had a meeting with us in Boston. And they put together a program to check how what we're doing is actually working. So for the next 2 years, I'm going to follow a big pile of people and follow their health and follow really how effective this approach is for improving health and maintaining or improving the neutral neural development of children in this area. The Tata Foundation, which is the biggest, Tata is the biggest industry in India. They probably own half of India. It's a family trust. They also are philanthropic, and their philanthropic arm is going to look after setting up the system of distributing all this stuff. Apparently, there are 70,000 stores in Uttar Pradesh which are providing really poor people with essential food items. And this double fortified salt will flow into that marketplace and will be provided, and they will look after doing the appropriate labeling and all the education that's required to actually have people try this. On another project, we start January 4th, Grand Challenges Canada and Saving Lives at Birth, the same consortium, will fund the development of quadruple fortified salt. So we've gone from double to quadruple. The reason for this is we sort of knew that folic acid is a huge problem. The lack of folic acid results in a huge number of birth defects. They used to be the biggest cause of birth defects in Canada and North America. And since we've been adding folic acid to flour in the last 15 years, the number of birth defects have gone down by 50%. And as an added unexpected bonus, we have also decreased the incidence of a couple of different kinds of cancer by significant amounts. How that works, we don't know yet, and thank God I'm not in that business. But anyway, so we said, okay, so folic acid makes some sense. We'll put folic acid on it. This will be great, improving the health of women and decreasing the number of birth defects, saving lives at birth. But then we found out that folic acid deficiency usually also covers vitamin B12 deficiency. You don't see one from the other. And B12 deficiency leads to what's called pernicious anemia, which is a very hard to reverse form of anemia, which is typically deadly in a fairly short run. So the smart thing to do is put B12 into the same formulation. So that's our premise, and that's what we're starting with. We already did some background work. I mentioned just now the folic acid is the problem, leading cause of neurological disorders. And we found out that the amount of folic acid needed is similar to the amount of iodine needed in salt. So if we could co-spray the two, it would be very simple because it just go into an existing plant, essentially putting a bag of iodate into the water that they spray on. We would also add another bag of folic acid in some form, and it would work. And it's not that simple, but anyway, we sort of gone along and found out that folic acid solubility is really better in higher pH, and salt typically tends to be at low pH, so there is a bit of a problem there. So we decided, so if you can buffer the system, then we could do a better job of it. And this shows you what happens if the solution is at low pH, and salt is usually around here. After a period of time, the amount of folic acid in the spray solution just drops right down to less than half. However, if we buffer it and we're in here, we can maintain over a period of, this is a period of 6 months. Now, usually you spray out this stuff 2 weeks. So if you can make it stable for 2 months, it would be great. And you can see that after 2 months, this buffered system retains essentially all of the folic acid. You can also, in the same solution, the iodine is completely preserved in the first couple of months. So we have a pretty good system. So we tried this on salt, and when we fortified salt with folic and iodine, we found out that the iodine retention was essentially 100%. And the folic acid retention was pretty good as well. It's very close to 100%. We're very good. We actually make some by storing it, which is sort of the experimental error in this thing. So we need more work to test the best methods for putting all four. We have to figure out where we're going to put the vitamin B12. We have essentially a number of choices. If you're really lucky, we can put it in the spray solution. I really don't expect that. Otherwise, we can incorporate it in the iron premix, and we can incorporate it either in the fat core, in the center core, in the whitener, or in the outer coating. So we have three other spots. And if none of that works, we can just microencapsulate vitamin B12 on its own and add a mixture of two different solids to the salt. And so this is what's going to happen for the next 3 years in terms of research, and I really look forward to it because I think it's going to make for a very nice and relatively simple system in the end. We have another line, and many of you know Claire Kennedy, who's on our board and board of advisors, both for the faculty and for chemical engineering. She is a chemical engineer who became a lawyer and is a governor of the Bank of Canada. Anyway, she saw that we were working on and was quite excited about it, and she had all kinds of friends in the music area and came up with the idea of coming up with something that will help in a disaster situation and would be, remember they had a Live Aid concert where ADE was spelled AID and life was LIVE. And she came up with this idea, and actually she trademarked this name for our protein that we extract from mustard seed. The beauty of this thing is that most proteins from vegetable sources are not soluble in a carbonated beverage because they're not soluble in an acid form. So the beauty of this mustard protein isolate is that we can dissolve it in essentially either a juice or a carbonated beverage like a Coke, and it becomes much more attractive and has essentially all the essential nutrients of milk. It can have protein, it can have calcium, and it can have all the different vitamins added to it in a form that people will actually drink. So we're sort of slowly pushing ahead with that, and Dean has been very kindly giving us a little bit of seed money, and Professor Yuling Cheng and I are working on actually putting together a package that will be a representative of what could be done. And the idea is that you can use this in disasters or in refugee camps or places like that, or eventually even just in places where there's no safe source of water and other nutrients for children. So based on what I've said so far, to me it's pretty clear that the application of sound engineering can lead to economically and socially acceptable ways of improving the situation of people in the third world. So finding the appropriate technologies and having the whole package, it's not enough to come up with just a single idea and a single product. You need to have the whole package of making sure that people will accept it, the organoleptics are right, meaning flavor, color, taste, that we have a way of measuring it and a way of manufacturing it. Once you have that package in place, then the engineer can feel comfortable in putting this out. So I think we will have this kind of approach, not just by ourselves, by others, and not just for these compounds, but for others, can go a long way to actual solutions to what's called hidden hunger, which is micronutrient deficiencies. I will close with a couple of slides. This one is a bit of showing off. The red ones are where my students are professors. The green ones are where my students have come from, graduate students only. So as you can see, our reach has been pretty good over the last 30 years, and it's been extremely satisfactory. I will close on this slide. Of course, this is where the work in India is happening. The gentleman on my right is Dr. Shinovo, who is a colleague and who's worked with me, but unfortunately he passed away last week. And so this is a bit of a memorial to him. On the positive side, one of my students just been appointed president of a university in Taiwan. So with that, I'm open to questions.
All I can say is, wow, what we don't know about, you know, we hear a lot about needing water in these countries and sustainable water supplies and so on, but it's obvious that there are things that can be done to the food supply to improve the health and the say longevity or lives of people in the third world. And you also hear about things like the Gates Foundation, but never hear what have they done. And it's great to see one example of that. I don't know if you followed last week, but Mark Zuckerberg of Facebook also announced a foundation. As he's starting, he's putting 99% of his wealth into some sort of a vehicle to support these type of activities as well. So anyway, questions? Yeah.
I didn't hear you.
Yeah.
My name is Bob Worrell. I'm diabetic, so I watch my salt and I drink lots of tea. Now, my question about Tata, I drink their tea. Well, it's under the name Salad. So I was just wondering about how those teas are available to us, and they properly diagnosed with the correct amount of salt and suitable for diabetics. The tea,
Typically, salt is not added to tea typically. Okay, in the processing. And your label should, especially in Canada, we have a pretty sound labeling laws for this sort of stuff, not for many others. If you look at your box of Tetley's tea, it will tell you what levels there are. And certainly, the Tata Group's companies that deal in exports are very sound and soundly managed companies with good quality control and pretty good people. They can afford it. Okay, I'm not sure the average poor person in the village in India would be getting, matter of fact, I know for sure they're not getting a Tetley's tea. They'd be getting sort of the leftover powdered material that's sort of the rejects of the export part. But the local consumption is actually much bigger than the export. So, yeah. Yes?
Would you have a market for your fortified products in, let's say, Canada? Like, have you looked into that? Maybe getting some royalties from that to fund your research?
I've been trying to get royalties from my other stuff, not this. But the whole salt thing came about essentially as a philanthropic exercise, and all the patents have been out on royalty-free with licenses to a couple of people. However, and the reason for it is very simple. The men in this group probably are getting more iron than they need as it is. And so there's also a pretty good data to show that excessive iron in the diet increases your chances of heart disease. And as a first-hand experiencer of that, I can see why I would not want to have more iron in my diet than I already get. So the market for that would be very limited. And you can, if you have a limited population, okay, so young anorexic girls are the biggest problem, okay? If you can get to their brains, you can easily bring up the iron to tablets, which is easily administered. The problem with supplementation in a large scale and in a developing world is, if you think about it, how often have you forgotten to take your prescription medicine? So if you don't have an educated public, you can't rely on them to really dose themselves properly. If you have an uneducated problem, then the problem with supplementation is that if one iron tablet is good for you, then 20 must be really, really good. And so you run into a problem. Yeah. So in that sense, the fortification works. For us, we don't want to hit the whole population, so it's not really appropriate here.
Question in that regard is, of course, we hear a lot now with the new government, we're hearing a lot about the indigenous nations and their issues. And are some of the developments you're doing, would they be helpful to them, or is it a case, again, of distribution and education?
Well, distribution and education is always the heart of all of this stuff, so there's no doubt about that. The problem with the indigenous population, and you can't really lump them all together, by the way, in many cases, there are diseases that are partially due to the climate, partially due to the lifestyle, and partially due to excessive alcohol. So there's a real problem in dealing with abuse of substance abuse, alcohol primarily, and it really leads to essentially you're leaching out of your body a lot of the micronutrients, and so you know how do you deal with that?
Any other questions?
Sir,
I was interested in recently, they were talking again about climate change and so on, and the growing deserts, and the work that they're doing to try and get maximized production with less water. I was wondering whether you've been involved with anything of that nature.
Aside from being interested, no.
Yeah.
No, that's a totally different field.
Yeah.
And there's all kinds of developments there on hydroponic agriculture, on drip irrigation, where you put the water where it's actually needed. And there's an awful lot of research in developing plants which are drought resistant, both by traditional plant breeding methods and by genetic engineering. And in India, by the way, child death and childbirth is still very, very high in China as well as in India. So we have made strides, but you look at the number of people that have problems due to nutrition in North America, say, well, yeah, maybe 100 years is not enough.
Over there.
First, I'd like to say that the work you're doing is very commendable. Obviously, that it's a philanthropical venture on your part to be in looking at third world countries and helping. My question really is, although the additives that we're talking about, iron, things that we know about, and we assume that they are going to be beneficial to everybody, but could it be possible that later on we may find that one or two of these ingredients that we're adding may have a detrimental effect? And the example I'm thinking of is adding fluoride to water, for example. Many years ago when it was introduced, everybody thought it was the solution to all our problems, but now we're finding that maybe there is a downside to some of these.
My kids don't have any cavities and I have 31. That answers your fluoride question. But anyway, the compounds I deal with are very simple. So this is not like a complex system, like changing the diet or like some of the more complicated pharmaceutical compounds, which are very complex, have really unknown detailed physiology and can have side effects of different kinds. Iodine has been added to salt starting in Switzerland in the 1920s. So it's close to 100 years. And certainly there has never been any documented case where adding iodine to the diet has created anything but good in the sense of improved, significantly improved neural development and improved IQs over a period of time. Iron is, the case is similar, it's not identical, but it's similar. And again, we're dealing with very simple substances that get incorporated fairly quickly into essentially two key systems. One of them is myoglobin, which is the red color of the muscle oxygen carrier, and then there's hemoglobin, which is the blood's oxygen carrier. So I'm not worried about those two. Okay. The fact that we don't know enough is shown by the folic acid, luckily, because the folic acid had an unexpected positive effect. It could have just as easily could have had a significant negative effect as well, and it's always a question of risk management. You know, if you increase the number of deaths by 50%, and that these people die 25 years later, you're still giving them 25 years. So yeah, you'd like to eliminate that, but it's important to think about this, and I think it's a very important question that you raise. You have to be careful and you have to keep looking, but as I said, in the two things I'm dealing with, it's not really a concern.
Dave?
Is the salt that is in soups iodized?
Depends. In the States it doesn't have to be, in Canada it has to be.
So can you get too much iodine?
No. We already are getting about 5 to 8 times as much as required. And the way that you tell that we have a good iodine status is that you measure the iodine in the urine and it's the same as you're taking in, which indicates that your body essentially discards all the excess.
Okay. Let me thank you very much. I think this has been a most interesting discussion. And if you want to see it again, it'll be on the website in, 2 or 3 weeks?
Yeah, and, even sooner.
Or sooner.
Yep.
And but I think we've learned a lot about, you know, people were asking about, you know, getting into the system. I think the big challenge is getting this stuff into things where people haven't access to it already because of stuff they buy in the store or that sort of thing, right?
And the other limiting factor is that we need a replacement for me and the faculty.
My cousin's husband is 72, has been looking for a replacement for a rheumatoid surgeon or rheumatism expert in Kitchener-Waterloo for the last 10 years. He would love to retire, he just can't.
Read the
same place. Yeah. And interesting to see that you're continuing to do this work for a few more years. So obviously, even though you and I are about the same age, you've still got a lot of ahead of you.
As I say, I'm not retired, I'm just off the payroll.
He joins Bruce Kidd, who's just 2 weeks older than me, and he just took a 3-year contract. So, which sort of leads into my next thing, but one of the reasons Bruce is out there is because of the new Pan Am facility out there. And he will make sure it gets well used by 3 different constituencies that it's designed for. Thanks, Levy.
My pleasure.
And I want to move, wrong way here. There we go. And as I mentioned, Pan Am Games, I was a volunteer the Pan Am Games. I worked for the U.S. Olympic Committee. I drove the chief security officer of the U.S. Olympic Committee, a former White House Secret Service agent, who in 1975, when a lady pulled a gun on Gerald Ford, he stepped in front of Gerald Ford to take the shot and wrestled the gun from her. But I had lots of other experiences, and one was UT had a reception at the new Gold Ring Center. How many of you have heard of the Gold Ring Center? Okay. This is an amazing new athletic facility in Devonshire, or that's what the street's called, right? Devonshire? Across the street from Varsity Stadium. Financed by the Gold Ring family, and Ann Gold Ring is chair of the Board of Governors right now. They had a reception for alumni, students, staff, and faculty who were volunteers for the games. And present there were people like David Peterson, who was chair of the game, a former chancellor of the university. The current president, what's his name, Myrtle? And former Lieutenant Governor David Onley, because he was representing the Paralympics side of things. I met an athlete by the name of Sasha Gaulish, who turns into an amazing story. She's got a master's of engineering in civil, and has been a consultant on road safety for several years. She's now a PhD student in civil on what's it called, engineering education, she's combined her athletic prowess, a along with her academic. She won the bronze medal in the 1500 meters. If you look at this picture, the heel has come off her left shoe, foot. She ran that way for the last 1350 meters. And this leads into the homework exercise I'm going to give you, because when we send the message out for the next one, we're going to put a link up to Sasha's site and you can read the whole story. Three weeks ago, she was up at Rideau Hall, where she won an award for being one of the top eight academic all-Canadian university athletes. She was CIS is the National Athletic Organization's Canada's version of NCAA, Track Athlete of the Year. U of T won some major track and field championships under her leadership this past year. And she has an advanced coaching diploma, both for runners and skiing. And this sort of leads into why we've got her as a speaker. She will be talking about advanced engineering education with lessons from the track. It's much like athletic training. Learning relies on motivation, perseverance, engagement. If you read some of her blog posts on her website, you'll get more of the flavor of that. Talking about how coaching principles can be transformed to engineering education and how to do performance planning. One of the things I've learned following these athletes is, you know, they have a program, they have a plan to get where they want to do. In fact, Sasha decided also she wanted to run some longer races, and last weekend she won second place in a half marathon in San Antonio, recording the fourth fastest half marathon time for a Canadian this year, and she's only 10 seconds off the third. So, she will be talking to us on January the 13th. And whereas Levy was showing you where all his students were, Levy's wife has had students in one city, Toronto. One of those students was Sasha. So he's coming back next month with his wife. Was there anything else? That was it. Okay. Good enough. Thanks very much, and we'll see you in, I think it's 5 weeks. Yes. Okay.